and both teams' coaches have the support for their junglers, obviously. Peter, before the day, said that I'll dominate, best jungler in North America. Locodoco said Santorin was heavily underrated as well. Maybe we'll find out a little bit of that.
We will.
This game will decide it all indefinitely.
One game. This is it.
We're already picking the MVP. One of the two junglers, whoever wins this game, whoever gets first blood, we're locking in the vote.
Just kidding, by the way. All right, so bans coming off the bat. One jungler is up there. Nidalee already taken out for Santorin, one of his favorites.
Dominate's Echo goes away as well. So right now, Team Liquid getting rid of a lot of the team fight powers here and a lot of the early pressure that Santorin might put on. So I think maybe Rek'Sai first pick could be a possibility if they are pinching junglers.
Definitely looking to be the case. Three jungle bans already.
Although, I Will Dominate definitely has had some good Sejuani games. Well, one good Sejuani game, but he's had them more in the past as well. So if they pinch junglers, there's actually not that great of a delta between, I feel like, I Will Dominate's Rek'Sai and his Sejuani. We'll have to see. Rek'Sai would be a nice pick, but I don't know if it's priority here. Alistar is still up. There's plenty of stuff.
It is interesting because you can sort of force a team play style if you force the enemy team into a certain jungler pick as well. And that could be more of an overall strategy coming into it. So definitely curious here what the first pick is going to be, because top lane, the main two, Ryze and Hecarim, are off the table.
All right. Now the rush pick onto the Kalista. So the Alistar still left up, the Nautilus still left up. It seems like the tier list says those two are close enough together. In Team Liquid's mind, it's all about Piglet getting a strong lane, letting him abuse a 2-on-2 against a traditionally weaker Wild Turtle and Lustboy.
Yeah, and in two games this year on Kalista, Piglet is 20 kills and 1 death.
Oh, man.
He's been rather effective on Kalista, but of course you're trading the power picks right here. They are choosing Kalista for Piglet, but of course they give TSM a lot of control and tankiness there with the two picks.
Wow, yeah, those are two really top-tier champions. It is worth noting, you talked about his Sejuani play. 5.11 is the patch that actually had the Sejuani nerf in it. The W was a tooltip change, but not a gameplay change, so actually a significant amount of Sejuani damage is off if he wants to go for it.
I'm seeing a lot of possible roams mid for TSM already, just in the first two picks with the way picks and bans are going. I would be fairly scared if I was Phoenix. Peter talked about wanting to protect
Phoenix.
Phoenix. Already,
come on, man.
You're looking at a Rek'Sai and Alistar. Alistar may be the best roaming support in the game right now. Very, very scary for mid laners. We'll see if Lustboy can make it happen. There is the Sejuani that we're expecting, and you do kind of force that playstyle a little bit more safe early game onto Dominate. So while they talked about, you know, player tendencies, jungle is such a fickle, you know, role. You have to take into account so many things. Now they're going to be on basically opposite champions from what they stated they really like to do.
Yeah, and I'm interested as well that Bjergsen picked Azir this early. Sometimes you can save your last pick for a mid lane counter, but a lot of people are free to pick Azir very early. It's also a denial pick from Phoenix. Not to mention, they already had a potential top lane counter pick against the Rumble, but they're still saving that last pick for Dyrus's top laner.
With the Rumble stolen away, it removes one of his more common pickups.
It's something he's been spamming in solo queue. Like, when you watch Dyrus' rise to the top 10 of the NA solo queue ladder, it's pretty much all Rumble and Hecarim games. Hecarim has been banned by Team Solo Mid, and Rumble is taken by Team Liquid. I feel like he's going to default back to Gnar. Oh, will we see a Jace, though?
Yep.
Jace got so many buffs. I believe we are. Yeah, since we're on 4.11, Jace got so many buffs. With not having to level his R anymore and getting them automatically, Jace got a lot stronger. Basically, his poke does a lot more damage because you can just feed points into the Q earlier, and it maxes out the top end damage after maxing all ranks going up to 6 is a lot higher.
All ranks of Jace's spells go up to 6. His 5th rank in the spell isn't as strong as it used to be, but because you get automatic points in your ultimate when you level up at those breakpoints, as well as the top end being higher, it is definitely a buff, but it takes some time to turn on. Late game power for Jace.
True. Now, all of his spells were not affected the same way either. So some of them got a lot bigger high-end impact, which is the Q mainly.
Yep.
So we'll definitely look for some poke from Team Liquid before they go with the Sejuani Rumble combo. It's definitely, they have so many tools here as far as the team fight goes for Team Liquid. Plenty of AoE to back up Jace Poke.
All right, well, the full lineups are in. Team Solo Mid with a team fighting composition. They've got the Gnar and the Azir in here, and of course, plenty of engage from the Alistar as well. But Jat, you talked about shoehorning a team into a certain play style. Dominate on the Sejuani now, and he's picked up more team fighting champions with the Rumble and the Annie here. So these teams very much about brawling with a bit of poke in the backside.
Team Liquid definitely wants to team fight, but they have a very real wombo combo setting up. Annie into Shock Blast, into Equalizers, into Glacial Prisons. It could all be very well and done. Whereas you see the TSM side, a somewhat balanced team composition, but both sides, I feel like, have crafted compositions that are capable of engaging fights.
That's always a strong thing for both these lineups. So as the players load themselves into the game, champ select is done. We do have the rest of the swaps coming through. It's all the spots you expect them to be in. Standard TP flash top lanes, and Team Liquid now only playing their second top five team of the NALCS.
Very curious heading into this one too, if they're gonna opt for the lane swap, because the Gnar and Rumble is pretty much a draw right there as far as a head-to-head. But Kalista Annie is so ridiculously scary. And Team Liquid have Sejuani, which you would like to have a lane swap if you're the Sejuani player, you know, so you aren't forced into a lot more of those early moves.
So then positive things on both sides, then we're going to see how the lanes shape up. Let us know how you think the game is going to go, and let us know who you think is going to win. Tweet hashtag TLWin or hashtag TSMWin to @LOLEsports over on Twitter. Let us know who you think is going to win this one. Team Liquid with a chance to take control back of first place. Team Tilamid able to put themselves back on the throne as they sit at 4-2. They're looking for some wins here.
Yeah, and I do want to just keep talking about the dual lane matchup right here, because TSM has had a lot of struggles with Wild Turtle and Lust Boy's synergy in general. So they need to be able to stay safe wherever they go, whether it's in a 2v2, they don't want to die there, or if it's in a lane swap, they don't want to poke their heads too far in the lane and suffer early casualties then. Wild Turtle in many ways has regressed a bit this split from last split into some old tendencies. We used to always say that Wild Turtle would get caught out of position, that he was unreliable. And then for much of the spring split, he was a reliable late game carry, but that has kind of defaulted back into a guy who gets caught a lot in their losses this year.
Yeah, I think that Piglet and Xspecial are going to do what they can to try and find Turtle and Lust Boy in lane in the 2v2. Try and punish Alistar early on, abuse the range advantage and the harass that Kalista Annie can get off.
Yeah, remember, until Alistar hits level 2, he just doesn't do anything in the lane. So.
Well,
not anything meaningful.
A lot of
he walks up and pulverizes you.
Oh, that's scary.
But it's a matchup we've seen abused before, so we'll see if the early levels can go well. Traditionally, engage supports work well against Annie because she's squishy and can get bursted out, so just things to watch for across these four players here in the bottom lane. And it will be the bottom lane. Looks like we'll have the Krugs start for Team Liquid and the Gromp starts for TSM. Corki, Alistar, not the best Gromp killers. They will be a bit slow to lane.
Yeah, but at least equalize the level 2 fairly well. Obviously, Kalista Annie are gods at killing these Krugs early on in the game as far as dual lane combos go. And they'll, I think, have the early game edge in the lane to keep pushing on.
So we'll see how that dual lane backs up in the future. Right now, Phoenix is going to be up against Bjergsen in the mid lane. These are two of the absolute scariest mid laners in the entire league. Bjergsen thought he was stealing away the Azir. Phoenix happy to play Jace on this one. And Bjergsen did a great job of hiding behind his minions. First shock blast he's taken all lane, I think.
True enough, but Phoenix does find his mark when he finally does pull the trigger. So, standard lanes already. Piglet and Xspecial trying to zone off and abuse that Alistar early, like we were looking for. He is able to get off a decent amount.
We'll say Xspecial took a good chunk of damage when moving up to trade there. He's going to have to consume his potions, but it does look like Team Liquid will hit level 2 first, which gives them presence in that.
Yeah. Also, I like what he did, especially on the Annie. Didn't go for the W charge and fountain to try and get any kind of crazy early level 1 strategy of a stun, but the Q harass versus the melee support matchups really does add up. So he was able to get his stun charge just from spamming Q.
Yeah, and this is interesting, this top lane matchup with Dyrus and Quas. This split has been actually very different for Dyrus than the previous split. He had the lowest percent of his team's damage for a top laner of pretty much any top laner in North American LCS last split, whereas here he's on kind of the higher end, and even a higher percentage of his team's damage than Quas, who has carried his team in many of the games. So a sneaky amount of damage coming out from Dyrus thus far in the summer split.
Yeah, we saw a real change in focus from the TSM management and the TSM analysts after MSI, putting a lot more focus onto Dyrus, as we said. And that investment, you know, has started to pay off. They do not ignore Bjergsen, though, as they do often send support as well as jungle there early. So far, though, having gotten a first back here already on Sejuani with, you know, no action, Dominate's fairly happy with the first 4 minutes of the game. Rek'Sai, obviously Santorin is the Rek'Sai player here and hasn't gone for many level 3 ganks, but he hasn't used a level 3 package in a long time. Here comes level 4, though.
Flash knock up on a Phoenix, plenty of damage dealt early on this one. The Flash and Summoner heal burn, so a 2-for-1 Summoner trade. A bit of damage here for TSM.
Pretty much just completely sacrificing his Flash in the mid lane for the lane advantage for Bjergsen. That gank wouldn't have burned anything if Santorin had not decided to burn his Flash. So now his gank presence on other lanes is diminished, but the mid lane will give Bjergsen an edge.
Sounds like team's still a mid. The joke is that Santorin is Bjergsen's third summoner spell, and well, it's got a 5-minute cooldown here.
I feel like that joke's been around so long, you know, even since Reggie and Odd1 were TSM players.
That's true.
But I like it. Delve deep into the past.
Well, we'll see then if a repeat gank comes through. The Flashless Jace, and he doesn't have good escape tools on his own anyway. So it could always be scary. We'll see if an outplay ends up happening. We track the top lane matchup, and it's pretty close as well.
Yeah, actually, since we are centered on the mid lane here, we've seen a lot of mid laners trend towards cleanse nowadays. When you're facing junglers like Sejuani that have really, really high impact stuns at level 6, Bjergsen has gone for that barrier. It is fairly versatile, you know, whatever kind of 2v2s or scraps that you do get into, but he won't be able to escape that level 6 all-in Sejuani gank that can be really, really scary. Yeah. If Dominate's able to farm up straight to level 6, which it looks like he's doing a good job of, and you know, he may be taking into account Santorin's playstyle, opting for the Sejuani and thinking that he can get a pretty easy route to that level 6.
Well, so far Dominate not been contested, and the only thing Team Liquid's lost is a couple of summoner spells. Otherwise, the bot lane going pretty well. Piglet and Xspecial have eked out the tiniest of CS leads, and Lust Boy has reached level 4, though, which means they can turn this around for TSM.
As far as the Sejuani pick making it to level 6 as well, these first 6 minutes of the game have pretty much just been Dominate farming peacefully. Yes, his mid laner did have to flash heal out of it, but as long as that's not punished with a kill or a significant CS discrepancy, that's all good for Team Liquid. This is the type of early game that they want with the jungle Sejuani being picked here.
Yeah, and it's again the way that the whole team plays around the difference in jungle picks. When he is on a more aggressive jungler, they can play more aggressively. But everybody, you know, after having burned his flash, everybody's laying down wards. They had wards up in the river to try and protect Phoenix. Now he needs to play a lot more cautiously, though. No flash, no heal. Luckily, he's on Jace with a tier, and he can try and spam out Qs to get last hits without overextending until, you know, someone comes by to bring more vision help.
One thing that does scare me, though, speaking of vision help, is the Team Liquid dual lane actually playing on top of TSM's turret. Mm. They don't have any deep wards to track Rek'Sai, who can just jump a wall and suddenly be behind Annie. And with an Alistar lane, that is definitely, I feel, a risk.
Very, very true.
Yeah, it's a risk, but if we just look at the TSM trends throughout this split, the ganks have been going to either Bjergsen or Dyrus. It's a very rare sight to see a jungler down bottom lane for Team Soul mid, and Team Liquid is kind of preying on that fact. They're just shoved into an Alistar lane fearlessly and not even close to being punished yet.
Plus, it's always scary trying to gank a Kalista Annie lane. They are about to hit level 6, and at that point, it definitely becomes an issue of you have to bring teleports as well into it. Right now, both top lanes are level 6. So definitely going to be keeping an eye on the Gnar Rage Bar, as well as the forced recall timings of the top lane. Dominate is hit that level 6.
If they go before Lust Boy is level 6, there's a chance they get some kills here. If Lust Boy somehow hits level 6, though, this would be tough.
Kalista, Annie both have
Everyone
level
6. Everyone is 6. And... Nope! Oh. I thought it was going to go.
Yeah, Sejuani a little bit too slow. Unable to...
Is anticlimactic, but at least it zones them off.
I mean, his presence alone is going to deny that entire wave. Plus, it looks like they're going for blue buff trades here, as Santorin is on the opposite side of the map. Dominate does not have eyes on him. I think they may have seen him venture into the jungle, though, because he's sticking around for this, going for this smite. Could have been stolen.
Yeah, got down to 11, but I think committing headbutt for that may have been a bit bold. Either way, it does go to Team Liquid, and the bot lane outer turret will go down. Great laning phase from Team Liquid, and the level 6 Sejuani secures it.
And the early game for Team Liquid has been really strong here, being able to withstand the one gank that Santorin pulled out and basically just destroying that bottom lane, sitting at the turret, getting it down. I mean, it's very rare that this early into a game, a 2v2 can just take down a turret of the enemy. Also, Sejuani versus Rek'Sai, the Sejuani team theoretically should be on their back foot, but that really just hasn't been the case. So big time credit for Team Liquid in this early game. In TSM's prior 6 games, they always had the gold lead at the 10-minute mark. It doesn't look like it's going to be the case in this one, 30 seconds to tell.
It really does bring up that point. All the members of Team Liquid were talking about last week, you know, their fairly new analyst, the Warlock, doing a lot of research into player tendencies. And it seems like they've played around the player tendencies of TSM players very well this game. The danger is that, you know, everybody is very aware of these tendencies and, you know, the mind games of will they continue to do that.
Yeah.
In the future are very real. So far, though, it really worked out for Team Liquid. They bet on Santorin being mostly farming in the early game, and their bottom lane went extremely aggressive because they felt like there would be no attention down there. All paid off so far for Team Liquid.
As an aside, I can't wait for the day when advanced analytics becomes a normal thing in League of Legends. Just being able to track like which direction a player would dodge for a hook, being able to track what percentage of jungler ganks on a certain champion depending on the game they're in, can be incredibly valuable tools long-term in League of Legends. We're not even close to being there yet. Other sports have been there.
People in the audience with cameras taking pictures of reactions and see if you can get facial tells from players when they're gonna go for...
No, okay. My favorite serious example of that actually was Cloud9 versus Samsung Blue at Season 4 Worlds. C9 had such a read on what Samsung always invaded on that they camped one of their own brushes and got like 3 kills in game 1 and won the game off it.
Yeah.
So there's definitely real examples of that kind of research paying off. I'm glad that teams are getting to that stage of their sort of practice regimen.
Yeah, and as it becomes more and more popular, teams have to always think about trying to use that, you know, use misinformation against other teams. You know, sort of creating a trend only to pop it against maybe the more important matchup that you have coming.
Well, an example of that would have been for Santorin to gank bottom again. Callista Henny.
Comes full circle here.
There we go.
Has not happened, though. And Team Liquid very happy with their objective lead. Looks like they're going to try and press it here with bottom turret down. Some early work done on this dragon, and Callista there to secure it.
But honestly, I just got to say, props to Team Liquid here. Their bot lane is winning. They're continuing playing through their bot lane. They've got a rended dragon right now. Oh, that's a clean, nice little play. But Lustboy level 6 is going to get stunned up. Engaged upon. Here comes the teleports. TSM going to join the fray first. Kwas going to be a little bit later. Lustboy, his ult's going to time out right now. And he's not far away from getting killed. A whiffed Sejuani will throw in Kwas. Going to pop the equalizer to buy a little bit more time. TSM are able to run back to their base if they want to. But Special flashes in. Lands the 2-man timbers. He finds the kill on 2 Wild Turtles. Santorin barely slinks away. But Phoenix is in the mix. But here comes Bjergsen, the savior of TSM. He's going to flash over his divide. He gets the kill onto Phoenix, but the battle is continuing as Piglet is not done here. Jumped right on top of Dyrus, trying to kite away. I don't even know who's supposed to win this fight, but right now it's a 1-for-1.
Wow, we waited 12 minutes for that fight. I'd say worth. That was incredibly exciting, but only one person going down on each side. It could have gone a lot worse for Team Soul Mid. Team Liquid had pretty much winning the entire early game. They get what was pretty much an uncontested dragon, and then a beautiful amount of damage from the Equalizer plus X Specials Tibbers. The fact that that is only 1-for-1 and TSM doesn't even suffer an objective loss after the beginning of that fight is a blessing.
Whew. All right, so dragon number 1 a little bit late for Team Liquid as far as stacking up 5, but they did secure it before this entire thing went off. The reason it took so long is because Alistar ultimate. Lustboy is able to soak damage for so long and buy time for the rest of the team. Kwas teleports in. Lustboy didn't expect him there.
It created this weird thing. Kwas gets down a great equalizer plus flame spitter, and I was waiting for the X Special flash. He flashes, then walks a little bit to get the double stun. Beautiful first kill right there, but a lot of their cooldowns had been expended at that point, so the follow was a little bit dangerous. Really nice timing by Bjergsen to go in at that exact moment, and then he also Emperor's Divides right into a wall itself, really splitting the fight, making the follow difficult. This Piglet flash at the end was a little bit crazy.
Yeah, man. I thought Turtle maybe would use his flash a bit earlier.
No ultimate left.
Special jump.
But damn.
Can they get another? Dyrus gonna hop. Doesn't get the double hop. Doesn't matter.
Team Liquid just feels like they are in absolute control. TSM really hasn't done any type of initiation move this game. There was one gank in the mid lane that burned Phoenix's summoner spells. Other than that, they've been completely reactionary, and Team Liquid is making the right aggressive moves.
Oh, very impressive stuff. Then they survive the first 7 minutes of the game, and then pretty much on cooldown, I Will Dominate shows up somewhere and says, hey, give me control of this map. And TSM obliges. It's a 2,000 gold lead for Team Liquid. They've knocked two turrets down to zero. They've got the only dragon on the map as well. It's so far looking great for the blue team.
Interesting little camp set up here by TSM on top of a pink ward, looking to come in from the side of this mid lane, just below your screen. Haha, surprise. They've got all the damage there, but they're going to need some CC to land. They're looking for Phoenix to get in range of Lustboy combo, but he's not going to do it. And Lustboy without flash, no surprising play that he can pull off. TSM bide their time, but gain nothing from it.
And it really feels like Wild Turtle's going to fall further and further behind. That was a wave of minions that he basically forfeit in the bottom lane to make that play. It would have been very dangerous for him to go down there because they've already lost their turret. And with Bjergsen on the team, Wild Turtle's not going to... I thought he wasn't going to be getting any CS in the mid lane. Bjergsen going to take the cannon right there. Obviously, Bjergsen have a big lead on Phoenix, but it's matched there by Piglet's lead over Wild Turtle.
And so Team Liquid continuing to scale up here, and with a really strong teamfight-based comp, you mentioned the Wombo combo potential.
Oh yes.
The ulties are available, but there's just not much to fight for as TSM have the wave clear to make sieging impractical. It's so far been around neutral objectives, a blue buff steal here or there, and the dragon when it respawns. Otherwise, Team Liquid happy to take their time. Santorin, nice attempted steal. Phoenix gets a blue buff pretty safely, and he's still scaling up on that Manamune. It's right now at 355 of 750, so still maybe 5 minutes away from fully stacking that.
Right, and he is almost level 11 there for Phoenix. That's where he can get his level 6 into the queue for the maximum shockwave possible, shock blast.
Yeah, and he's already clearing the back wave with one shot. So it's, yes, he has a CS advantage, disadvantage to Bjergsen right here, but no, it's not really going to mean Bjergsen gets a turret because with the blue buff plus the Muramana, it's easy wave clear from here on out for Phoenix.
And those are all good signs for Team Liquid then, as they have all the tools to stymie aggression.
Things are going fantastically for Team Liquid this game.
All right, so next order of business for Team Liquid then, since it's going so well, is to get up that ring of vision wards. Just outside the jungle. There's one turret left. Ah, there we go. Started already. If they can start controlling the vision game, TSM have to respect an Annie that not only has flash, but also a Kalista to throw her. If that Annie starts things off, you hold people in place for an easy ultimate from Sejuani, a Rumble ultimate. There's just so much that they can pile on. If vision is controlled, TSM have very limited options.
Second early smite we've seen from Dominate, leaving something at 10 health. Hopefully not a sign of things to come for a future Baron fight, but either way, Scuttler is controlled right on time for the dragon. TSM, though, able to slink into the jungle and clear some of these wards away, so both teams aware that this dragon in 30 seconds is the objective they want control over. Deep wards, a bit for both sides.
And I really actually like what Quas is doing here. Picked up the Blasting Wand instead of trying to wait around for an Innocently Large Rod or some other item in preparation for this dragon. 10 seconds left on it. They've got Teleport. He's been able to spend his cash. TSM not quite able to make the press in to take down the turret.
Yeah, even though Lustboy has healing, that's not going to save Bjergsen in time for this next dragon fight. Team Liquid landing the right bits of poke, and now potentially able to force the right fights. Quas is pushed in a little bit, but he has that temporary power from the Blasting Wand. This could be a very telling fight for the rest of the game. Team Liquid already with the upper hand, trying to get a stronghold on the lead here.
What they're doing as well, Kalista with the early lifesteal is able to start up the dragon while jungler clears wards.
Got plenty
Kalista
of rest secure even, but they time it right.
Yo, good Ren. Dominate, though, getting locked up. Santorin and Lustboy doing plenty of damage, but Lustboy pops ult. He's not going to get hurt much here. Quaz has teleported in. The Equalizer could be very sound. Special to put a little bit of lockdown, but now he's caught out by himself. The engage, not very useful. Wild Turtle gets stunned up.
Ooh.
In comes Phoenix, but knocked back out by Lustboy. Quaz still picks up two, and the battle continues with Santorin, Dyrus, and Bjergsen all just piling down. Two for two.
The terrain that these fights are taking place around makes for very, very awkward commitments from the teams, because everybody flashing in and out of the pit here ends up being the 2v2. Yes, the Dragon number 2 did go to Team Liquid, but they did lose control of the map as well. So the turret finally goes down and TSM gets some global gold for themselves.
Yeah, we are seeing some really crazy fights. This one was heavily dictated by the teleports themselves. Quas did a lot of work with his teleport, but Dyrus may have even done more with his. He zoned out the majority of Team Liquid in this fight to make it a 2v2, because Team Liquid did have the upper hand, I feel like, coming into this one. Again, it's a fight that starts out with Lustboy just being a wall that Team Liquid can't go through. Notice Dominate couldn't land his ultimate because it's basically just going to hit the tank. Right as Piglet would have wanted to rend, he has to respect Dyrus from the back with the flash ultimate.
Ooh, special.
But then, watch Quas.
Great Rumble ultimate. Also, the Sejuani stunned him. Perfect time for the Rumble ultimate there. Right on top of it. He was burning. And Xspecial starting it off by failing that flash over the Dragon Pit. Definitely, that was the wrong foot for him as well.
Yeah, but as it all pans out, we get ourselves back to a very close game. Team Solo Mid, as we saw, knocked down the outer turret in the aftermath there, brought the gold within 1,000 here. As Team Liquid have the ability to have bonus attack damage and ability power, they kill turrets a little bit faster as well. Maybe future sieges go well. But right now, Solo Mid equal in the mid lane. Bot lane actually going slightly Team Liquid's way as that one's being pushed in by Piglet. So map control to me is the thing to watch for.
So Quas is actually trying to rush a Void Staff, it looks like, with his early blasting wand. Since Quas has stacked so much magic resist, or Dyrus has stacked so much magic resist, he wants to cut through it early. All four kills, by the way, onto Quas. So their power is definitely focused onto that Rumble. And the importance of landing a good Rumble ultimate is even emphasized more so. So he has all the cash.
Yeah.
So while Dyrus has nearly equalized the gold here, this is actually the first game this split that TSM has managed to.
Oh, you didn't even do that on purpose. Okay.
What did I say?
Nothing.
We'll figure it out later.
We're going to move on. This is the first game this split TSM has not had a gold lead at either 10 or 20 minutes here. Yep. We talk about Team Liquid having a great early game play despite the shoehorn Sejuani. This is blue skies for these guys.
And the strengths and weaknesses of the teams as well throughout the mid and late game. Team Liquid has shown a strong affinity to close games when they've had a lead, whereas Team Solo Mid, despite having leads, have still fallen down on 2 losses. So if we take all that into account, it would seem like Team Liquid has a big chance of winning this game. Of course, they're going to have to eventually cut through Bjergsen's Azir, which is now death capped up 21 and a half minutes in.
Yes, he is. Thought you were making a corny equalizer joke, Greek.
Oh, yeah. I understood afterwards when I realized it said equalize and there's a rumble on the other side.
Well, let's see what TSM could do. Because as you said, not too far behind. Dragon stacking right now doesn't mean a whole lot for the team. And as close as the team fights have been, TSM can easily turn this game around.
I'm actually surprised that the Void Staff was such an early pickup for Quas, but I guess it's specifically for his Gnar matchup.
Yeah.
He's the only real magic damage dealer you'd normally see the flat pen focused build.
And even so, I feel like...
Well, it's not like he doesn't have the flat pen too.
That's true. Well, I guess Liandry's rather. The 2300 gold detour for Void Staff.
Or the early Zhonya's either for like a very aggressive play, because Quas loves to get himself in really dangerous situations.
Yeah.
Just to pull off the Flame Spitter Zhonya's combo. I can understand... with a lot of the split push focus that's going on right before Dragon fights, he needs to have pressure on Dyrus, so Dyrus can't teleport into full health for these fights.
It's interesting contrasting Dyrus's build with Zion Spartans we saw just last game, where Zion, in the exact same matchup, went Hexbrinker into
Black Cleaver
for the 1v1 power, for the damage. Dyrus is going straight to tank after that one, so different goals for the teams, different goals for the players. It's fun to see adaptations, though. It's always fun to me.
Yeah, I think Dyrus's call to go almost full tank, or basically full tank after Hex Drinker is really good, because the way that they win is him or Lustboy tanking the brunt of the AoE initiation, the AoE stuns that are coming out. They have to have Lustboy or Dyrus solo tank one of those, and that is what they're hoping for to win a team fight. If one of those two frontliners is not able to take the Sejuani ultimate and shield the rest of the team, you know, Bjergsen and Turtle are going to melt really, really quickly.
Well, we'll see if they're going to melt under the weight of Rumble damage. Team Liquid, pressure lead to the bot lane, equalized mid lane, Dragon's up in 30 seconds. Looking at Vision, we do have four wards in that blue buff jungle that Team Liquid has placed. TSM have three on that mirrored side in the southern jungle, so both ready with a bit of Vision.
Speaking of the dragon fight, Jerks
there it is.
Out of four at no this type of poke. Burns both his summoners and his low health, but the Sejuani ultimate is spent. 10 seconds coming into this dragon fight. I still feel like that's advantage Team Liquid because Bjergsen needs to be involved in this game. He's the only one with significant damage right now since Turtle's behind and Darius is going tank build.
Plus, they went for that move before the dragon spawned, so forcing Bjergsen back, they have control once again for the dragon, almost on cooldown. Team Liquid, another great objective-based aggressive play here. They don't randomly go for these mid lane ganks. Let's see if it pays off, though. Bjergsen's walking his way over right now.
Double teleports come in as well. The smite does come early from Dominate, as before, and Santorin gets the dragon pickup. Piglet was not in range to Ren. Now Quas TP's in. Plenty of damage onto Bjergsen, but he still goes down for that one. The mid laner will get equalized as Xpecial takes the kill credit. A 4v4. Dominate chunked low. No ulti for 30 seconds.
TSM lost Ren presence on the dragon when Piglet peeled off to the fight, but Dominate stayed on, which made the 50-50 smite worse. So a miscommunication between Dominate and Piglet, and the smite
didn't extend. Why even be there? Gnar goes massive. He's going to pick up maybe one or two, but Piglet has turned it back around, buys time. It's still the one kill for free onto Xpecial. Team Liquid running away. Phoenix actually snipes Lustboy in the backside of it. So another 2v2, but this time Dragon went to Team Solo mid.
Phoenix up in his tower here. He's constantly had the higher ground as well, and he's been very, very accurate with his with that Jace pick and the Shock Blast. Man, I really thought the bottom combo there was going to actually turn around on Piglet, but they respect the Rend, trying to save Lustboy, and both of them get out of Rend range. Does die in the end, so weren't able to save him.
This is turning into a really close game as well. That dragon going the way.
Daring the 1v1 here. Well, it's going to be 2v1, so he backs off.
Yeah. Piglet's not that crazy.
Wait a second. One person in that bush. I'm fine farming here. Two people. All right. That bush is too crowded.
Still got the CS.
Yep. All is fair. All is safe. This game now within 600. This lead barely exists at all, and TSM actually maybe to take their first lead of the game with this turret kill. Things are starting to look a little bit better in their mid game.
That smite steal was so important for TSM. Not only getting the 6% right now in the mid game, 26 minutes in is when you really want that single dragon buff for the extra power, but also denying move speed for Team Liquid, very important in reducing the ability for them to pull off an AoE combo. They really have to work with that precision flash Annie Tibbers, and less move speed means it's gonna be harder for them to get into position. See here though, vision control around Baron definitely does help them setting it up.
Yeah, and right now TSM has to respect the fact that Team Liquid have shown up. Problem is, teleports being down means splitting your top laners up is unlikely. You can see Dyrus stuck in mid, as is Quas here. Melee Adder will go down off the recall from Bjergsen. He just picked up his blue buff but had to leave the map otherwise. Team Liquid put themselves back in this slight lead. Dyrus actually has 1,500 gold in inventory right now. He's the only guy with a ton of money still to spend, but he might need to recall TP list before this next fight.
Yeah, well, unless the Baron is itself being forced, there's not many other objectives that are really being contested right now. So unless Dyrus is saving up for like a BF sword, I don't see any reason for him to be out on the map right now. He should have gone back about 10 seconds ago so he could have an item and defend this inner turret.
He's got the exact amount of money required to finish Banshee's Veil, and staying around is always a bit scary.
He is getting several boomerang hits on deck special, though. And chipping down that Annie early is a really good sign for TSM. If they can try and get one of their frontliners in her face, one of the biggest counters to Annie is having a pure tank right at the front and trying to deny her position to get her flash stun off. Right now, though, he's just playing games. Video games.
Everyone's playing video games.
I'm not. I'm watching them.
Sure.
Very true. Gotcha.
Gotcha.
All right, let's see. Oh! Lustboy misses the headbutt pulverize.
Counter
now
Dominic
has a chance to land the stuns, but doesn't go for the tanks. He turns it. No, only hits Lustboy, though. That's not the target he wanted. Dominic's going to die for that problem. Now, is there going to be a re-engage for Team Liquid? They're getting chunked out. Special gets dropped by Bjergsen. The fight continues. Quas kills off the TSM mid laner. Loses life force. It's a 3-for-1 in this fight. Wild Turtle off the chase, true to his name, but has to respect Piglet's damage.
That is exactly what TSM wanted. As I said, Lustboy gets the fake face tank, the Sejuani ultimate. He doesn't care at all. Pop his ultimate. He's in the middle of the fray, and TSM really, really, I guess that was a counter engage from TSM.
Because basically everyone on Team Liquid tried to kill Bjergsen, but no one was synced up because of the phase tank ult from Lustboy. The damage couldn't follow through. Bjergsen ended up getting off a truckload worth of damage before he eventually fell, and that's why TSM won that fight.
The ultimate bodyguard, Alistar.
Missed the combo, still do work on the fight.
Yeah.
Congratulations.
Doesn't matter. You can miss your combo as long as you stand in front and take the hits.
Yeah. All right. Add that to the Jace poke. Like, everything needs to go through something in order to hit a priority target. So, CX special flashed in.
Oh!
But Lustboy walks into just the right spot to tank the ultimate. And yes, the equalizer's in a good spot, but once again, not on the main damage dealer. And now watch Bjergsen Sand Soldier in that fight. Two full auto attacks off after it's placed. And then a bunch of damage on it. Quas.
Also, if we're splitting hairs here, Dominate did go with a flash ultimate instead of ult flash.
That's a worthy hair splitter.
Lustboy barely got his hoof in front.
Woo.
Very close team fight there. TSM come out with the victory and able to increase their lead. Let's see if they can get anything else off it. One turret taken down in the mid lane. The first of those secondary turrets from either team. Game still really close. Ooh. Game of the week definitely delivering.
Yeah, again the poke onto Bjergsen. That's one shock blast from Phoenix. And the sustain from Lustboy's Alistar, no way that can actually
Bump!
Well, it's now a half-health mid laner. The star performer of Team Solo mid. Maybe that gives Team Liquid some room to play because dragons respawned.
Yeah, Team Liquid knows a lot went wrong in the last fight, specifically the Sejuani ultimate. So if they can land a decent amount of poke with Jace, even though they lost the last fight, they can still see an advantage coming up. Dragon 3 for them if they're able to secure this one, but a flank coming from Dyrus. An incredibly pivotal moment in the game about to unfold.
Yeah, well, Ren kills off the Rift Scuttle. That's a nice thing for Team Liquid. They can watch the flanks.
Look at this, TSM, they set up the outpost of the Azir turret in the middle of the map and then transition up to Baron to start clearing vision. So Team Liquid have to respect the Baron threat here, and nobody is pulled towards the dragon.
Azir kills Baron so fast. Kalista is known for her Baron securing ability, but Azir will soon be known for his Baron killing ability. When he's auto-attacking with multiple soldiers on that thing, it just drops.
Phoenix, the sniper. Again, from the high ground, able to land another shot.
Yeah, it's definitely a one-sided advantage here. Team Liquid have much better poke than Team Solo mid, and this sort of nebulous mid-long-range stare down is slowly going Team Liquid's way. A bit of healing, but maybe not enough. Lustboy goes in pretty hard.
I mean, there's a chance this starts like the last fight did, is with a missed cooldown from one team, which creates an opening for the fight to start. No one wants to start a fight on even footing. And here's that Baron killing ability. Bjergsen takes a lot of damage here.
This is, yeah, a pretty big risk. Banner of Command had pushed the top lane in all the way, and Team Liquid only now responded to it with Quas, but they got some turret pressure, and they allowed Gnar to push the bot lane as well. Banner earns a turret.
One turret down. Quas working. Or Dyrus working on that bottom one, got it to half life before he has to retreat because they do not have substantial vision coverage in the red side of the Team Liquid jungle. Most of their wards are concentrated up by Baron.
And everyone got to recall and buy some new items. Team Solo mid now sitting 3,000 gold ahead. Dragons or not. The turret pushing from the Banner of Command and just generally good play by TSM puts them at 5 turrets to 3, 8 kills to 7.
Really interesting buy there by Bjergsen. He's bought Spell Vamp so he can sustain after getting hit by Phoenix Bow.
Wow.
One too many Shock Blasts will make him do that. He's delaying his Zhonya's to do that. We'll have to see if he gets caught in a fight and the Zhonya's comes back to bite him.
Plus, the Spell Vamp that you get from that on Azir takes a long time to get back to full life. from just one of those Shock Blast landings. So he's going to have to rely also on the Lust Boy heals.
Three waves worth of healing.
Yeah, fairly difficult to try and gain all of that life back, but he's tired of going back to base. So no, I mean, so I guess the other option he could have gone go for was invest in home guards and try and cut down on the time that he has to walk back. But right now, yeah, see, there's nothing for him to spell vamp off of either. So even though he has it, that shock blast, it gives Team Liquid control in mid lane. They transition down to Dragon, looking for the number three Dragon here.
Well, they're going to go for the two, man. The Ren should be enough for Piglet. Gets it.
It was at 65 life there.
He had another attack in the air. Second like hit of Ren got it. But yeah, Piglet slightly misjudged the damage. Team Liquid just keeps having these 50 health jungle monsters at the end of their executes. That one did go through, though. Three dragons to one. Team Liquid, good sneak on that. Their mid lane poke earned them a lot of room. And we're back now to the waiting game, where Baron's the only easily reached objective. Banner of Command is available. Lustboy can break the siege with that and push a lane down. Right now, that's Dyrus' job in the bot lane.
I feel like Dyrus' job has now transitioned into you need to make a godlike teleport flank, because this Jace poke, even though it's only Jace, is taking its toll. Phoenix constantly finding Bjergsen, landing headshots, and forcing objectives off of it. Three in a row. Well, not in a row, but Dyrus, he could change all this with a good teleport flank. The hard initiation is what they need.
Well, another thing Dyrus is doing is just creating a lot of split push pressure. Like, yes, there's teleport threat from both people, but Dyrus, ADCS advantage, big time lead. Lustboy, again, a missed pulverize. Team Liquid trying to get a fight.
They tried to build a flank on there. They had Bjergsen coming from the side, but Lustboy goes down to 10% HP, and they burn Dyrus' teleport for it. Kwas can easily just walk over.
One less flank option for TSM. Now they really have to respect the Flash Tibbers again from Xspecial. Again, this is a Kalista-assisted Flash Tibbers. So very, very difficult to work around, especially if Gnara is out of rage. TSM once again retreat. And the tension mounts where this game is so ridiculously close. Red team's turn. The vision control is paramount because of the importance of the next team fight.
Well, I'm going to take a look at the vision one more time. TSM looking decent in their vision. They've got the entire like bottom left side of the map covered up, while Team Liquid don't have anything to answer that. It's actually a vision lead won by TSM so far. They can track Team Liquid very easily.
Yeah. Kwas is also closing in on Zhonya's Hourglass. He's sitting on 2,086 gold right now. If he completes that, it's huge in these fights. It sounds like a broken record with every TSM game, but a lot of this will be about Bjergsen in the team fights, because if Team Liquid can kill him right away, I don't see a window where TSM wins the team fight. And he doesn't have Zhonya's, he doesn't have QSS, he doesn't have cleanse, and there's no Mikhail's. So a nice stun onto Bjergsen could mean everything.
Definitely true. Turtle did just pick up a Quicksilver for himself, so Turtle, one threat that we'll be able to cleanse. Here comes the forced fight, though. Teleport in.
And here we go.
Hard
engage. They stun Xspecial. Bjergsen's going to go down first. That's a one for zero. Lustboy, the easy chase. Santorin also in the fire. Double kill somehow for Xspecial. With a bunch of other damage deals on the team, the support, and he gets two of them. Wild Turtle forced to run away. He's looking to go back for Baron.
Why so many mid laners are taking cleanse nowadays? One mistake from Bjergsen and they crumble is what Dominic said in the video before the game. That's definitely going to be Baron for them.
What a nice combo by Team Liquid. Basically just letting Bjergsen burn. One stun into an equalizer, into an ult from Sejuani. Everything focused on him. That's all they needed. Baron for Team Liquid.
And with a Jace, how good is this siege? Team Liquid have all the tools to pull a gigantic lead. We can watch that fight again.
All right.
Also note how Dyrus' teleport was down from before, and they started this Baron while he was bottom lane, which forces this face check to begin with. Beautiful chaining of CC.
Yeah, barrier will not save you from that sort of combo. Goes down, and it's an easy cleanup for Team Liquid. Let's see what they do with this Baron-empowered siege that they have. As you mentioned, Jace is massive right now.
I really question Lustboy not having a Mikhail's Crucible at this point in the game. It's important to get an Aegis, but you can build the Locket on the Rek'Sai and have a Mikhail's on the Alistar, especially when the priority on Bjergsen right here is to not let him get completely wombo combo.
some sort of cleanse in any coming from anywhere would be great TSM. Whenever you're facing a wombo like that, you gotta have something
to
break
it. This game.
You need a combo breaker.
That's true.
Well, good killer instinct from you here, but right now Team Solomid have to try to keep their base alive. Lustboy stunned up again. None of the poke lands, so he'll be safe for now. Team Solomid so far okay to wave clear. It's worth pointing out, by the way, Gold is actually still identical. With all the extra turrets that TSM had killed through the Banner of Command that he did invest into, it did give some gold. So it's actually a 800 gold lead for TSM. That's now gone with this turret going down.
Now it's
their fourth.
Oh!
Nearly killing Wild Turtle, pushing around Santorin, doing damage to Dyrus as well. Solomid have to play back foot for the next 2 minutes.
Ooh. Yeah, Flash is still down in X Special. The Distortion Boots aside, he needs a little bit more for the Flash engage. Or they can try and Kalista ult in. Bjergsen would almost have to Flash away reactively because he didn't actually get to use it last fight since he got instantly CC chained.
A lot of pressure on Lustboy's shoulders here.
Yeah,
be on the front line, take the hit, and not mess up the alley combo.
There's that Banner minion, though.
Yep.
Looking for an inhibitor
turret. All of Team Liquid happy to stay in
the spot. That's Lustboy right there.
Yeah, Lustboy,
Lustboy's doing great things.
Looks like it's not going to die on this one, though.
Good job, Lustboy Jr.
So yeah, built some wave pressure, but didn't really build any meaningful advantage on the map. Just the one turret so far is his mark so far for that item. Lustboy's also going towards what looks like Talisman of Ascension Rush, not...
Yeah, Mikhail's nowhere near. So the CC chain threat will be a threat for probably the rest of this game unless Bjergsen sells an item to get a QSS.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of that spell vamp. I see what he was thinking with it. All right, well, let's take a look at this dragon here, though.
This is trying to trade for a mid lane push, but it's a dangerous move here by Team Solomid. They have a turret behind them. No real way of breaking the siege.
Yep. Oh, they might catch Piglet, though. Preemptive flash, a good set of harpoons by Kwasnik Special. He wants in. They look for Santorin. They find Lustboy as well. A whole bunch of burst, but can they get the rest of it done? Dyrus locked up a bit. Dominic gets the kill onto Lustboy. It's a 5v4. Santorin gonna get hit up, but Bjergsen finds one. Phoenix at the front lines. But look at the damage coming out from everyone at TSM. Piglet's the last man alive out of nowhere. He's got nothing to do, and the cleanup crew happens. TSM with the fight.
Lustboy soaked another giant stun!
X Special was only able to find Alistar, and with Bjergsen around the back, he was able to cut him off.
Yep, Bjergsen bided his time, did not get caught by any of the major CC. Dyrus got a beautiful Gnar ultimate, and the close from TSM was right there. Maybe they went off that fight.
I think they do, chat. 25 seconds on most of the major respawns. They've got a wave right there, thanks to all the pressure TSM already had. And would you believe it, from behind, Team Solomid will actually do it. They'll knock down Team Liquid. They'll improve to 5-2, drag them down with them, and TSM are going to end Saturday in second place.
What a game that was. 41 minutes right there. TSM only getting the kill lead at the very end. Back and forth from the start.
What a fun game when so much turns on a single team fight. Whew, and TSM are able to pull it off. You really have to be careful when you do have a team comp that relies on comboing all the ultimates so precisely. One misstep there is really, really going to cost you, especially if you give away the Alistar pick. This is why it's so heavily prized all across the world.
We really need to get a replay of that last team fight to see it again, because game-changing and game-deciding doesn't even begin to describe it.
I think that's a good start.
Excellent.
Okay, I would say that's a pretty good start.
Game-changing, game-defining begins to describe it. You can see Team Liquid still recovering from that one. It felt like they had the game in their hands. Four dragons, and in the collapse back from that fourth dragon is when TSM found the fight.
Whole game definitely delivered.
Yeah.
I was definitely satisfied with that game of the week.
Speaking of delivering, Bjergsen, okay, he got caught out once or twice, three deaths in the game, but 16,000 gold, 380 minions, highest in the game. Damage dealt's got to be massive for him as well. I mean, he was the cleanup crew of that last fight. The guy absolutely collapsed in the back line. He wasn't the one engaged in the very end. It was the pressure onto Lustboy, onto Santorin, maybe even onto Dyrus. And all the CC gets used on the non-major carries. In comes Bjergsen from the back line. Hardcore dive, sweeps in and clears everyone out.
Alistar, the premier combo breaker in the league.
Yep. Yeah. Yep.
Does it multiple times.
Yeah, so absolutely impressive then. Team Liquid.
Yeah, that moves TSM to 5-2, Team Liquid to 5-2.
Yeah.
Right? Team Liquid hadn't really had any quality wins against the top teams in the LCS, and they were in position to get at this game. Like, they're clearly on the same level, if not a better level than TSM, but those team fights down the stretch just fell right into TSM's hands.
Yeah, that's the thing. Oh, go ahead. Okay, yeah, so Team Liquid have played two top five teams. Gravity and Team Silamid lost both. They've beaten everyone 6-on-down. Those are their 5 wins, but Team Liquid, in these very close battles, have not been able to close them out, have not been able to, in the Gravity game, get the early game lead they wanted, or in the TSM game, close the game out in the way they wanted, even though we see these glimmers of greatness. It's a rough season to be a part of for Team Liquid fans, but either way, they will end themselves in second place today. Not exactly bad to be 5-2. We'll see how the rest of their season shapes up. But for now, going to send it down to Dash. And